I'm ready to throw in the towel with eclairs. Don't get me wrong, I love eclairs. I just want to stop tearing my hair out over them. If you bake them twice a week, like I did when I made my eclair video 3 years ago, you'll eventually achieve perfection. But if you bake them twice a year, like I do in real life, the results are inconsistent. Some tubes are too fat, some are too thin, some crack on the side, some crack underneath. When I don't practice for a while, I am lucky if half of my batch comes out right. But just because eclairs and I had a falling out doesn't mean I need to give up on crispy pâte à choux filled with insanely good pastry cream and coated in a chocolate glaze. Change the shape into a cream puff, and perfect results are guaranteed every single time. We'll start with the pastry cream because it needs to chill in the fridge for several hours. If you want to make your life easier, make it the day before. Set a 2-3 quart pot on the scale. Add 242 grams of milk, 242 grams of heavy cream, and 100 grams of granulated sugar. Cut half a vanilla bean in half lengthwise and scrape out the seeds. If you don't want to use a vanilla bean, you can replace it with a teaspoon of vanilla paste or extract. Add the bean and the scraped out seeds to the pot. Give it all a stir and set on the stove over medium-low heat. Place 2 large eggs and 32 grams of cornstarch in a small bowl and whisk them until completely smooth. Some recipes use flour instead of cornstarch, but I find that flour leaves an unpleasant starchy taste. Be patient, you really need to get all the lumps out. When the milk comes to a simmer, remove the vanilla bean and pour a ladleful of this mixture into the eggs while whisking. Then we need to strain this mixture either into another bowl through a fine mesh sieve, or if you don't like dirtying too many dishes, you can use a little fine mesh strainer spoon to remove all those undissolvable pieces of egg and whatever little lumps of cornstarch that your whisk missed. Bring your milk to a full boil and take the pot off heat. On an electric stove, remove it from the burner. Dump the eggs in all at once and whisk immediately. Turn the pot back on medium heat and stir constantly. Within a minute, your cream will start to thicken, but it won't necessarily do it evenly. This is when people panic that the eggs are scrambling. They are not. The presence of cornstarch makes it very hard for your eggs to scramble. It's just that the bottom is thickening faster than the top, which gives the mixture a temporary look of scrambling. Stop panicking and whisk like crazy, and within a minute you'll have a perfectly smooth cream. This is the stage where most rookies make a terrible mistake of taking the cream off the heat because they think it's done. The problem is that the eggs contain an enzyme called alpha amylase that will digest and deactivate your cornstarch. To prevent that from happening, we need to destroy that enzyme by boiling the cream for 1 minute. When you're whisking constantly, it's hard to tell when the full boil occurs. Once your cream is nice and thick, stop for a few seconds and see if the cream is burping and sputtering. Not yet. Let's keep whisking and check again in a few seconds. Now? Yes! We have a boil and now we need to set the timer for 1 minute and whisk. By the way, when you are choosing a pot and a whisk for pastry cream, make sure they are a good match. If your pot has straight sides like mine does, you'll need a pretty skinny whisk so that you can get into all the corners. This whisk is called a French or piano whisk. Mine is made by Kun Rikon. Take your cream off heat, stir in a tablespoon of Grand Marnier or some other liqueur and a little pinch of salt. I do it to taste. You'll be amazed how the flavor of the cream becomes more well-rounded with a little salt. Add 3 tablespoons of cold unsalted butter cut into 3 pieces. It's a good idea to have your butter pre-measured, chilled, and ready to go before you start making the cream. When the butter is completely dissolved, your cream is done. Now you need to act quickly so that the cream doesn't form a skin. If you have good quality plastic wrap that is heat resistant, the best thing to do is line a quarter sheet or some other small baking dish with it. Then pour in your cream, spread it out, and press another piece of plastic on top. This is the fastest way to cool the pastry cream, and that's what most bakeries do. If you're not sure about the quality of your plastic wrap, use a 1-quart heat safe container and cut a circle out of parchment that fits its top perfectly. Cool on a rack for 30 minutes and refrigerate until completely cold, which will take about 3 hours for this flat dish and overnight for a tall container. Our next order of business is to make pâte à choux. Preheat the oven to 350 Fahrenheit with the racks in the upper third and lower third. In a small pot, combine 120 grams whole or 2% milk, 120 grams water, 1 teaspoon diamond crystal kosher salt, which is half a teaspoon of table salt or 2.8 grams of any salt measured on a high precision scale, and 1 teaspoon of granulated sugar. Add 1 stick of unsalted butter cut into about 8 chunks to help it melt faster. Set the pot over medium heat and keep an eye on it while measuring the rest of your ingredients. Set a plate and a sifter over a scale and zero them out. Measure 142 grams of bread flour. Bread flour is the key to pâte à choux that stays crisp and doesn't turn soggy as it sits. Sift it onto the plate. Now set a cup with a spout on the scale, zero it out, and measure 230 grams of eggs. That's somewhere between 4 and 5 eggs, depending on whether you're using large or extra large eggs. If you have too much, whisk the eggs together and pour a little out until you get 230 grams. Even if you got a perfect amount of eggs, give them a quick whisking. Let's go see how our pot is doing. We need to get a full boil and all the butter melted. To keep things heating evenly, give it an occasional stir. As soon as you get a full boil, take the pot off heat and dampen all the flour. Mix it thoroughly with a spatula or a wooden spoon. If you get any flour lumps, smash them with the back of the spoon. Make sure you scrape everything off the sides and keep mixing until you get a smooth, homogeneous mixture that looks like mashed potatoes. Be patient and keep smashing those lumps. Set this mixture over moderate heat and cook it for 5 minutes, stirring constantly. Do use a timer. A common rookie mistake here is getting the heat wrong and not stirring evenly. Let's address the heat. On an electric burner, don't start your timer until the burner is actually preheated. If your mixture doesn't start to make a quiet sizzling noise after the first minute of cooking, raise your heat a little. Here's what your pot should sound like. If you see even a hint of browning, lower your heat. I find that when people stir, they sometimes shift off the burner or lose contact with the burner. That's not cool. You need to stay right over the heat. To ensure that the dough cooks evenly, spread it in the bottom of the pot, scrape towards you, and flip it over. Spread, scrape towards you, flip. If you are doing this right, your pot should form a bit of a skin on the bottom, at least if you're using a stainless steel pot. This skin is perfectly normal, and that's an indication that you have enough heat. When in doubt, it's better to cook the dough for another couple of minutes than to stop too soon. It's also totally normal for some butter to ooze out of the dough. It will emulsify right back in when we add the eggs. The more moisture we get rid of at this stage, the more eggs your dough will be able to hold, and the more eggs it will hold, the more lift you'll get in the oven. When 5 minutes are up, dump the dough into a mixer bowl, but do not add the stuff that got stuck to the pot. Fit the mixer with a paddle attachment and let the dough cool for 5 minutes, turning the mixer on once in a while for a few seconds to help the steam escape. While our dough is cooling, let's prep the pastry bag. You can certainly pipe shoe with any half-inch opening, but I prefer this tip. It's Ateco 864. For all the equipment links, look in the description below. Other brands have different numbering systems, so you want to search for something called French Star Tip. Place the tip into a 16-inch pastry bag, push it all the way, mark where you want to cut the bag, pull the tip back and cut. Push the tip back in, making sure it's completely secure. It's okay to stretch the bag some. Roll up the bag just like a sleeve, otherwise the mess will be scary, so don't forget the step. Before we add the eggs, let me give you a little warning. The amount of eggs that I use is very high. Some recipes go as low as 200 grams and I use 230. I do that because I like the excellent lift this amount of eggs gives me. But in order for your dough to be able to handle it, it requires that you cooked enough moisture out in the previous step. It also requires that you used bread flour. If you're using all-purpose flour or if you are not sure how well you cooked that mixture, reserve a little bit of egg and see if your dough needs it. I'll show you how to judge the texture. Our dough cooled for 5 minutes and we are ready for the eggs. Turn the mixer on low speed. Add about a quarter of your eggs, turn the speed back up just a little, and wait for the eggs to get absorbed. When the mixture smooths out, drop the speed to low, add the next addition and turn up the speed just a little. Always wait for the mixture to become homogeneous before adding more eggs. Periodically scrape down the sides. Keep going like this until all the eggs are in. Give it one more scrape. Turn up the speed to medium for a few seconds until everything is very smooth and even. By the way, you can make this dough with a hand mixer fitted with spiral beaters or in a food processor. I'll include the process instructions in the recipe below the video. Here's the texture you are looking for in the end. If you dunk the beater or a spatula into the dough, you should get a V shape. The dough should be very soft, but it shouldn't drip from your beater. For me, it takes the entire 230 grams of eggs, but your mileage will vary. Transferring the dough into the piping bag always makes me wish I had a third arm. That's why I use a glass to hold up my bag. The next rookie mistake is bad piping. I'll give you a bunch of tips, but here is the bottom line. Good piping comes with practice. Make a batch of pâte à choux, pipe it, collect the back into your bag, and keep piping until you are good at it. Collect the edges of the bag, grab it with your fist, and flip it so that the tip points up. Twist the bag to tighten it up and to move the dough into the tip. Open up the hand that holds the bag. This is where the pressure will come from. If you press near the tip, you'll be choking your bag and running out of dough on each puff. I find that this dough bakes more evenly if I use inverted baking sheets so that the walls don't reflect the heat. Dab the corners with the dough and place a piece of parchment paper on top. The dough will glue the paper in place so that it won't slide. The best way to learn to pipe is to practice on a scale. For small puffs, shoot for 12 grams and for slightly bigger ones, shoot for 15. Today I'm going for 15. Any contact between the bag and the scale will change the readout, so you should completely ignore the number on the scale until you finish piping and lift the bag. Don't sweat every gram. Anything between 14 and 16 grams is good. A few more tips on piping. After you flip the bag, add your guiding hand. This hand shouldn't squeeze, just guide the bag. Find a good distance from the baking sheet so that the dough doesn't fall in the ribbons. If it does, you need to be closer to the baking sheet. Keep the bag at 90 degrees to the baking sheet. Make a tiny swirling motion with your hand. Stop all pressure and then lift off. If the dough keeps dragging after you as you lift off, it means you are still pressing on the bag. Keep re-tightening the bag as you pipe. Piping with a slack bag is very difficult. Each standard half sheet can hold 16 puffs. You'll need 2 half sheets for 1 batch of dough, and it's totally normal to have a bit of dough left over. Make sure you stagger your rows to help with the heat distribution. If you're new to piping, you might want to mark the locations where you want to pipe with a pencil and then flip the parchment paper over. This way you'll make sure you distribute the puffs evenly. To steam up the oven, I like to use little disposable baking pans. You don't need to throw them away. I've been using these 2 for years. Pour 1 inch of water into each one and place them onto the floor of the oven. Splash the puffs with water using a spray bottle. If you don't have one, you can wet your hands and shake them all over the puffs. Spray from all directions so that the puffs are evenly damp. This will slow down the browning, allowing them to expand more. You should see lots of little droplets on the baking sheet. Dampen your finger and smooth out the little tails. Place 1 sheet of puffs on the top rack and 1 on the bottom and shut the oven door. If you have a convection fan, turn it on. Normally, baking 2 sheets of anything at the same time is a recipe for disaster. But for the cream puffs, it's actually beneficial. This produces more steam, helping them to expand better. It's also convenient. Now set a timer, and until it goes off, you should not open the oven door under any circumstances. This is a huge rookie mistake. Checking up on potash too early will make it collapse. After the timer goes off, you can take a very quick peek. If the puffs look brown, give them a squeeze. They should be completely hard. If they are not, keep baking them. In my oven, the top rack always needs a few more minutes than the bottom rack. Once the puffs reach this color, it's completely safe to open the oven and move them around. When you get your puffs out, turn off the oven and remove the pans with water. We'll need it like that to finish drying them out. If you plan to fill them from the top, poke them all the way through in 2 spots with a skewer or a thermometer. This will allow the steam that is trapped inside to escape and will allow your puffs to retain their crispness. But today we're filling our puffs from the bottom. So I'll use the same handy dandy French dip that I washed out and dried out to poke the holes underneath. Wiggle in the teeth of the tip inside the puff and remove that little piece of crust. Then take a skewer or a thermometer and poke through any soft cobwebs that are left in the puff. You don't need to remove those tiny bits of soft dough, you just need to make sure they don't make a solid barrier for your cream. Once all the puffs are poked, place them on a baking sheet with the holes facing up and return them to the turned-off oven for 10 minutes to finish drying them. I know what you're thinking. Why do we want such dried out puffs? That's because they're normally filled with very moist and creamy fillings. The fillings will soften the puffs, so if you want the final texture to be pleasant, we need very crispy puffs. By itself, the pastry cream is just kind of eh. But we are not going to use it by itself. We'll turn it into a diplomat cream by folding in some whipped cream. That's why the amount of cornstarch in my pastry cream is relatively high. I need the pastry cream to be stiff enough so that when the soft and fluffy whipped cream goes in, I still end up with something that I can pipe. Whisk the pastry cream to get it back to the creamy stage. It's totally normal for it to be a bit rubbery out of the fridge. In a chilled bowl, with a chilled whisk, beat 230 grams of heavy cream. Start on low speed, but fairly quickly bring it up to high. When your cream is foamy, but doesn't yet hold the peaks, add 60 grams of crème fraîche. You can buy it at any supermarket these days. The tang in the crème fraîche will balance the sweetness in the pastry cream. Keep beating until your cream holds stiff peaks, but be careful of overbeating. In the end, it can go from perfect to grainy within a few seconds. Your cream is done when the beater holds a stiff peak, and if you tilt the bowl, the cream should barely move. If your cream is too soft, the filling will be too hard to pipe. Shake out the whisk you used to beat the pastry cream. You won't need it anymore because we'll be adding the whipped cream with a spatula. Add a third of the whipped cream and fold it in. Bring the cream up from the bottom of the bowl to the top with one hand and rotate the bowl with the other hand. Don't press down on top of the cream so as not to deflate it. Once the whipped cream is mostly incorporated, add the rest and keep folding it in until the mixture is completely homogeneous. To pipe the cream, we'll use a Teco 804 tip. It fits perfectly inside the holes made with 864. Move your pastry cream to a bag. I prefer to work with a bag that's not overly full, so I add about half of the cream. Once I pipe that into the puffs, I'll add more. Insert the tip into the puff and squeeze very hard. A huge rookie mistake is not filling the puffs completely. There is nothing worse than biting into a half-filled puff after putting in all this work. So I think it's better to press so hard that an occasional puff cracks than so soft that they are all half full. Here are some signs that you put in enough cream. You'll see a little cream coming through tiny holes on the side. That is if you have tiny holes. When you stop piping and let the puff sit for a minute, the cream will start to come out of the hole just a little. After all your puffs are filled, take a knife and tidy them up. If you feel that the bottoms are still too messy, you can touch them up with a paper towel. To make the chocolate glaze, bring 113 grams of heavy cream to a boil. I do it in a microwave, but you can use a small pot. Add 113 grams of dark chocolate. 60% cacao content works well for me. Chips are easy because they don't require chopping. Stir until the mixture is completely smooth. Then add 25 grams of light corn syrup. This is crucial if you don't want the glaze to become hard and dull after it sets. Whisk thoroughly. Dunk your puffs and shake them off. I know the puffs look very pretty when they're just glazed, but biting into one now would be a mistake. The glaze is too soft right now. Give them 30 minutes in the fridge and they'll be perfect. That's when the magic happens and the pastry cream, choux, and glaze become more than the sum of their parts. They become a delightful cream puff. If you don't want to serve them immediately, no problem. They can live happily in your fridge for about 24 hours. Here are more culinary tutorials for you to check out. And if you are ever in the Boston area, maybe I'll see you in one of my classes.